So I have stepped out as a proponent of a national e-verification program and testified on behalf of Lamar Smith's bill to do this. And I believe that we need something mandated by the federal government. And I'm not a federal government mandate type of person. You know, I like the government to be smaller and less intrusive. But I also understand that we need something that covers all 50 states. Because what you have is you have each state doing this, then you've got situations where one state won't do it, the other state will, they become competitive disadvantage, and they don't put it in for the wrong reasons. Okay, so if it's required for everybody, and everybody has to play by the same set of rules, I believe that's what we should do. Okay, I actually encouraged Florida to pass it, not because I think Florida should be involved in this, because I think the federal government should do it, but I encouraged Florida to pass it because I felt, just like Abraham Lincoln did, that, you know, this is a bad law, we got to fix it. You know, if the federal government's going to sit on their fanny and not do it, then let's get out there and do it.
How much did that implementing that actually cost? Did you ever have a chance to figure out what it costs on a per employee basis to actually use the E-Verify system?
For the company?
Yes.
Very negligible. A little bit more expensive for small business owners that maybe not have access to the internet. It's a free service. All you do is you log on to a website, federal government website, you take the people, that information, it goes into the data bank. Within 24 hours, you get a response back that says yes or no. Okay? And it also, if there's a mismatch on the Social Security number, you have the ability to have that employee go clear it up. Okay, to go to the Social Security Administration, so forth. Now, very good question, because this is not easy, okay? But I believe if you look at why we have such a huge illegal alien problem in this country, a lot of it has to do with the supply and demand of jobs. They're here because they're opportunity, okay? Now, some people might argue that there's a lot of Americans that don't want to do these jobs, okay? And I share some of that understanding. You know, I grew up in Texas and in Florida, and my mother picking cotton in South Carolina, there's a lot of people that wouldn't choose to do that for any amount of money, particularly given the kind of unemployment insurance program we have here, when the option is that you cannot work at all and get money. That's right. But nevertheless, if the law says, okay, that you have, there's a process for you to come into this country, and there's a process for you to be able to work, then as far as I'm concerned, that's the end of the story. Okay, and everybody needs to step up and be part of the solution. And until we get the American people to buy into the fact that this is not something we're going to tolerate, we're not going to make progress on it.
Okay. So, long answer to your question. That's okay. Who was paying for the cost of implementation? One of the complaints that the agricultural people interests in Florida had, if I guess, the E-Verify, was the, you know, cost per employee to have them verified. You know, they were talking, it was, I forget which one of the senators it was, but was talking, it was going to run something like $20 million altogether to implement this thing, and it was going to be on the backs of the people using it. So in the federal program, I mean, there's a cost. You've got website maintenance, you've got, you know, there's all kind of personnel and things and that have to be paid for somehow. So if you're saying that the restaurant really didn't have to come up with any money, where did the money come from to fund the system? To come out of general tax revenue?
This will be a federal program. It will be, the federal government has to maintain this data.
Okay, we don't have any money left, so how much is it going to cost per person to do that?
Well, let's think about what the cost of having illegal immigrants in our country and the pressure that it puts on our social programs and medical and schools, okay? Now, there's a trade-off there, so you're absolutely right. That this would be another federal program that has to be funded. My answer to that is that either you change the law to make it easier for illegals to come here and work legally, okay? Easier to come here and work legally, okay? I'm not a proponent of that necessarily, but that is one way, okay? Now, on agricultural workers, there is such thing as a guest worker program that's out there, okay?
And that works.
It works, but it's very restrictive. Okay, it doesn't allow, then there's a limit on how many can come in, okay? And so that program, that gets back to what I made. We need to have better legal immigration laws as one part of the solution to the illegal immigrant problem, okay? But if there's a tool out there that's collecting that's electronically feeding in the same data that's in the back room of this restaurant, I think that the as part of a solution, you got to include that. And this program in the build of Lamar Smith, it has a 5-year phase-in program because you can't flip the switch and say this is going to apply to everybody tomorrow and everybody's going to be able to, you know, to get this done.
But if the federal government wants to pass a law bad enough, it's amazing how it works. I mean, we've got this stupid light bulb thing. We've got stupid laws that they're not officially even involved in. But we've got a thing where you don't know who's coming across your border, north or south. And I lived in California much of my life. California was just, I mean, there were parts of it. They even changed the signs on the freeways.
Bilingual.
Things. And not bilingual, it was Spanish.
Spanish.
We had to follow the drawings of, you know, the little man running across the freeway and a line through him. You know?
Yeah.
but I mean, really,
I've seen those signs.
Really, if they want it done badly enough, but instead of that, they keep everybody busy with this little crappy thing of light.
Right,
so you're all thinking about it.
Well,
I don't
want to
use those sort of things.
But you know, what you're talking about, ma'am, is priorities. Where are the priorities in our country?
Okay. They want to, because it is cheap way to make votes.
Well, from the standpoint of dealing with light bulbs compared to our national debt. That's the comparison that I make. And when it comes to immigration, would every one of us that are like-minded about a law and order, respective law and so forth, there's an equal number of people out there that would like to see us give amnesty to these people. There's a lot of people out there that would like to see us do that. So we have to acknowledge that to accomplish the issues surrounding national security, getting control of our borders, securing our borders, we're going to have
It's raining up the mess.
I'm sorry?
When Reagan gave it out, there was no follow-through. So that's what it just built up. And if I was a legal immigrant waiting to come into the States, I'd just go to Canada and come down. I mean, because that is the way they're doing it.
Could we talk about a topic?
Yes, ma'am.
My question would be about taxes and tax reform. Do you know what fair tax is?
Oh, yes, ma'am. In fact, my younger brother spent a very, very brief time, so don't hold that against him, not me, as an IRS agent about 30 years ago. And he called me back then and said, this system is so bad, and what we need to go to is a consumption tax. I tell him that he invented the fair tax, okay, because our system is broken. People that should be paying taxes don't. People that do should be paying less. But we have to get from where we are to a new, flatter, fairer system, and it's going to take some time. But there's no time like the present to start that. We have to start, okay? Let me tell you what I think that I can bring to the United States Senate that most other opponents, in fact, I would say all the other opponents in my race can't bring, okay? It's a connection to Main Street. We all think, or at least when you listen to these folks talk, we're going to be saying the same thing. Let me tell you what I'm going to be saying differently. And that's going to be that my life's experience is the fact that I've been signing in front of a check all my life, and I've actually put 40,000 people to work in my career by creating opportunities for people. And I understand where Main Street is. I understand why people are so frustrated. And it's not about philosophy. It's about the type of people we send to Washington and whether they show true leadership, and are they going there and spending all their time worrying about their votes in case they have to get reelected? Or are they going there to do the right thing? And I tell people, if I get elected to the United States Senate and I serve one term, okay, and all the decisions I make are based on my heart and my mind that are right for the American people, and they don't reelect me, that's fine. That's fine. You know, I'll go do something else, and I'm not a young man, so I don't have to worry about doing something for another 50 years, okay? And I think that's a refreshing, different type of person in Washington than a career politician. And I know Adam Haskin, I know Mike Haridopoulos, I know George Lemieux, I haven't met Colonel McAllister, I'm going to meet him tomorrow. These are good men, okay? They haven't done what I've done, okay? They believe a lot of the same things I believe, okay? But can they show leadership? Can they convince other people? Can they talk about immigration like I talk about immigration? They can't. Because unless you've done it, you don't have the same perspective. You know, watching someone drive a car, you might be able to tell somebody how to drive a car, then behind you get the wheel, come off the wheel, you don't know whether you can drive a car. And I've been a business guy all my life, and I've been in the service business all my life. I have the ability to communicate with people. I have the ability to get people to come around to my point of view. That's what leadership's all about. We don't have enough people in Washington that have actually done enough in their lives. They can sit across from another U.S. senator and convince that other U.S. senator that my perspective is the right one. Because if you haven't done it, you're just going to be talking like a lawyer talks, and that's trying to convince somebody that something some way, regardless of the fact that everybody looks at it a different way.
You need to have some kind of principles.
Yes, ma'am. You have to be principled. You have to be principled. And I can't, you know, I can't turn my back on the fact that I'm a business guy. I've been working for small business owners and fair playing field for businesses. I understand where jobs come from. Government doesn't create jobs. They create an environment. Okay? The environment right now stinks. Why are people not investing capital? Because the environment is so uncertain. People are sitting around being very, very concerned about whether they're even going to be able to have a job, whether they're going to have a car, then be able to keep their house. So people don't spend money, they don't buy more goods and services.